Hello everyone. In this class we will discuss about the forced harmonic oscillator. In the previous classes, in the first case we discussed about the simple harmonic oscillator, where the oscillator is moving with a natural frequency and it can continue its oscillations. Then we considered the case of damped harmonic oscillator, where the amplitude of oscillation will decrease continuously. Since there is dissipative forces such as friction will play a role. So in order to sustain the oscillations, we must give some energy externally in order to make up for the losses happening in the systems. So we can do this one by applying external forces, and we don't need to have the same frequency of the damped oscillator. The external forces can be of different frequency. The damping or the resistive forces always try to retard the oscillation, whereas the applied forces will try to maintain the oscillations. So finally, the oscillator will vibrate with the frequency of the external driving force, and these oscillations are now called the forced oscillations, and the oscillator is now called the forced or driven harmonic oscillator. So we, in order to sustain oscillation in the case of damped harmonic oscillator, we should give some external supply. So these external forces are called the external force, and the corresponding oscillations are called forced oscillations. And after some time, the system will start moving with the frequency of the external force. So in a such a system, we need to consider the different forces acting on the oscillator. So the first one will be the restoring forces, that is as in the case of simple harmonic motions, there should be a restoring force which is proportional to the displacement, but in the opposite direction. That is, the restoring force is equal to minus kx, where k is the force constant. The second type of force is the damping force, which is proportional to dx by dt, which is also in opposite direction. So there is a minus sign here into gamma dx by dt, where we define this gamma as the damping coefficients. Then the final, the third force is the external driving force F, which is equal to F0 sin pt, where F0 is the amplitude of the external force and p is the angular frequency of the driving force. So this is an important factor, which is the p, which is the driven force frequency. If m is the mass of the oscillator, then the equation of motion can be expressed as m d square x by dt square is equal to sum of the forces which we discussed above, that is minus kx minus gamma dx by dt plus f0 sin pt. So this can be rearranged as d square x by dt square plus gamma by m dx by dt plus k by m into x is equal to f0 by m sin pt, which can be again written in this format, that is d square x by dt square, and we substitute for gamma by m, which is equal to 2c. So c is a parameter which depends on the damping coefficients. Then k by m, which is omega 0 square, which is the natural frequency of the oscillator. So omega is equal to square root of k by m, and for f0 by m we substitute as small f0. The equation number 3 is the linear non-homogeneous differential equations, which can be solved by assuming the solution is of the form that is x is equal to a sin pt minus theta, where a is the amplitude of the oscillator and theta is the phase difference between the driving force and the displacement of the oscillator. We can differentiate this one with respect to t, so that you will get dx by dt is equal to ap cos pt minus theta, and d square x by dt square should be minus ap square into sin pt minus theta. Now we can substitute for these terms in equation number 3, which is the differential equation. So you will get minus ap square sin pt minus theta plus 2c a into p cos pt minus theta plus omega 0 square a sin pt minus theta, which is equal to f0 sin pt. Then we can combine the terms which involving the coefficient sine pt minus theta and cos pt minus theta on the left hand side. On the right hand side, for this expression we can rewritten as h0 sine pt minus theta plus theta. So that we can express this one the in the form of sine a plus b, which is sine a cos b plus cos a sine b. So this will be f0 sin pt minus theta into cos theta plus cos pt minus theta into sin theta. There should be a bracket here. Now we can equate the coefficients of sin pt minus theta and cos pt minus theta on both sides, so that you will get a omega 0 square minus p square is equal to f0 cos theta and 2cap is equal to f0 sin theta. For squaring and adding these two terms, on the right hand side should will be f0 square, but the left hand side should be a square omega 0 square minus p square all square plus 4c square a square p square. From this we can take the a square outside, which is a, where a is the amplitude of oscillations, which is equal to you'll get finally a is equal to f0 by square root of omega 0 square minus p square all square plus 4c square p square. Now you can substitute for the amplitude term in the solutions which we defined here, that is x is equal to a sin pt minus theta, so that you will get the expression for displacement, which is x is equal to this term, that is f0 by square root of omega 0 square minus p square all square plus 4c square p square into sin pt minus theta. So from this term you can get the expression for the phase term, that is theta, which will be you can divide these two terms, so that equation 10 divided by equation 9, you will get tan theta is equal to 2cp by omega 0 square minus p square, so that theta is equal to tan inverse 2cp by omega 0 square minus p square. So we have the expression for the amplitude of the driven oscillator, which is this one, this term f0 by square root of omega 0 square minus p square all square plus 4c square p square. So the amplitude will be maximum, this term will be maximum when the denominator is minimum. And this will be corresponds to the derivative of the denominator terms, that is d by dt of this term should be 0. That will be the minimum value which corresponds to, we can take derivative of these terms d by dt of omega 0 square minus p square all square plus 4c square p square. So you will get this term 2 omega 0 square minus p square into minus 2p plus 4c square into 2p. From this you can resolve the expression for p, which is the frequency of the driving oscillator, which is equal to p is equal to square root of omega 0 square minus 2c square. Thus the amplitude of the driven oscillator is maximum when the angular frequency should be equal to this term, that is p should be equal to square root of omega 0 square minus 2c square. This phenomenon, when the amplitude of force oscillator becoming a maximum for a particular driving frequency is called resonance, and the corresponding driving frequency is called the resonant frequency, which is represented, we can represent it as pr. So pr corresponds to those frequency at which the amplitude should be maximum, that is corresponds to p is equal to this one, which we can call as pr, that is the resonant frequency. So we can get the expression for the maximum amplitude of the driven oscillator as when we substitute for pr here instead of p. So that will be ar is equal to f0 by square root of omega 0 square minus pr square all square plus 4c square pr square, which is equal to f0 by square root of omega 0 square. Now we substitute for PR, which is the resonant frequency which we defined here. So this is the resonant frequency, that is omega 0 square minus 2C square, and this will be also omega 0 square minus 2C square. We can solve this these terms, and we can remove the this omega 0 square here, and you will get a 4C raised to 4 here plus 4C square omega 0 square minus 8C raised to 4. From this we can take 4C square outside, so that this will be equal to F0 by square root of 4C square into omega 0 square minus C square, which is equal to F0 by 2C. You take this 4C square out of the square root, it will be 2C square root of omega 0 square minus C square. This omega 0 square minus C square can be expressed in terms of PR, which is omega 0 square minus 2CR, which is equal to PR square plus C square. So that you can express the amplitude in terms of PR, which is the resonant frequency. Next section, we will consider how the amplitude will vary with respect to the frequency of the driving force. So for that, we will consider three cases. First one is for lower value of driving frequency, that is when P, the driving frequency, is much smaller than our natural frequency omega 0. So when P is much smaller than omega 0 here, we can express the amplitude of oscillations, which is equal to this one, that is F0 by square root of omega 0 square minus P square all square plus 4C square P square. If P is much smaller than omega 0, we can neglect these terms, the terms involving P raised to 4 and 2P square here, so that you will give the denominator will be omega 0 square all square, on square root of this one will be omega 0 square. So you will get the expression for the amplitude, which will be F0 divided by omega 0 square, which is F0 we define as the capital F0 by M. So it will be F0 by M omega 0 square, but we have the expression for omega 0 square, which is K by M. So that this will be equal to F0 by K. So that means at lower driving frequency, the amplitude is determined by the force constant. So at lower frequency, this will be smaller. The amplitude should be always smaller. In the second case, we consider for higher driving frequency. That time, the P value is much higher than omega 0. If the driving frequency is much higher than the omega 0, again, in these expressions, if P is much higher than omega 0, we can neglect the terms involving omega 0 square, omega 0 all raised to 4, and we can also neglect this term. So the P square all square should be, that is P raised to 4 should be the larger term in the denominator, so that this term will be F0 by P, so that the amplitude will be A is equal to F0 by P square. And again, since F0 is F0 by M, this will be F0 by MP square. So from this expression, we can see that A is proportional to 1 by P square. That is the P is the driving frequency. That shows that the amplitude decreases as the driving frequency increases. So the amplitude will be lower at the lower frequencies when the frequency is much lower than the natural frequency. Also, if the driving frequency is much higher than the natural frequency, again, the amplitude decreases with respect to 1 by P square. Next, we consider for the smaller values of damping. That is, 2C square is much smaller than omega 0. So, that means in the resonant frequency term here, if the damping, if it is much smaller, we can neglect the 2C square, so that the PR should be equal to square root of omega 0 square, which is omega 0. So, PR is equal to omega 0 when the damping is much smaller. So when P is equal to omega 0, that means the when the driving frequency is equal to the natural frequency of the oscillator, then we can neglect this term, because P is equal to omega 0, so that amplitude will be F0 by 2CP. That will be the maximum amplitude which is called the resonant amplitude. That is, resonance occurs when the frequency of the periodic force is equal to the natural frequency of the oscillator. So the maximum amplitude will be AR is equal to F0 by 2CP. From this we can have the following conclusions. If C is equal to 0, that means there is no damping. So that is not practically possible. Even then, if C is equal to 0 here, the amplitude should be infinity. So that will be infinity, which corresponds to 0 damping. So let's next case, if the amount of damping is low, that means C value is smaller, that time also the amplitude will be maximum when compared with medium damping or heavy damping. So we can see that the rate of fall of amplitude from its maximum value at resonant frequency on either side of the resonant frequency with change of the driving frequency, which is referred to as the sharpness of the resonance. So the rate of amplitude will be lower at the lower frequency and higher frequency, and when the frequency which is equal to omega 0, that means that when the driving frequency is equal to omega 0, the amplitude will be maximum. Regarding the amplitude value, this will be maximum when the damping is minimum. So when the damping is increased, the maximum amplitude value will be lower. So at C is equal to 0, if there is no damping, amplitude becomes infinity at P is equal to omega 0. The concept of force oscillations and resonance can be better understood in this particular experiment. Here you can see there are 5 bobs, and these 2 bobs are having same length, so their natural frequency are same. Whereas this bob has got a shorter length, that means their natural frequency is higher than these 2 bobs. Whereas these 2 bobs are having longer length, so that their natural frequency will be lower than these 2 bobs. So we can see that when this bob, which is having a forced oscillations, and we can observe the other 4 bobs, and you can see how the amplitude is changing for other 4 bobs. You can see that this bob start oscillating, and now slowly the other bobs also oscillate, but we can see how the amplitude varies. So when the bobs of same length, when we oscillate the other one, you can see that this will be having a larger amplitude, whereas these 3 bobs having much lower amplitude of oscillations.